Selamünaleyküm dear brothers and sisters. We are broadcasting live from Channel A9 and Harun Yahya Studios in Istanbul. We are together with Sister Gulen, Sister Begum, Sister Duygu, and I'm Dolunay. Tonight we will talk about lots of topics, science leading to faith topics, misconceptions of evolution, and also end times and Hazrat Mehdi. First of all, we would like to start with the science leading to faith topics, and one of them is the mosquitoes, also stated in the Quran.
Yes, mashallah. This is very important animal. It has many astonishing properties. After mating, the female mosquito stores the sperm in a special pouch and can lay the fertilized egg over a period of weeks. And the female starts drinking blood from the time of mating. As we know, they drink blood, but they drink it because they need to feed their baby. And a human pregnancy cannot be prolonged, but certain creatures are able to do this. And even though the time to lay the eggs has come, some mosquitoes lay their eggs not after the first rain, but they are waiting the second or third rain. This is very important why they are waiting. And this is a prudence to protect the mosquito's progeny. There is a high probability of the moisture or the petals on the ground, which left by the first rain, they may be dry up because there is no so much rain, and that's why they are waiting second or third rain to prevent the dryness. And this means that the larvae would be left on the dry ground if they are laying their eggs after the first rain, and so would be unable to develop. Larvae cannot develop on the dry ground. It needs moisture. And this is only a probability. However, the mosquito acts as though it knows that this probability. It takes a measure and it waits second or third rain. How does the mosquito know that the moisture content of the ground may not be adequate after the first rain, and that the puddles, which is on the ground after the rain, may dry up in a short time? They cannot know that. Allah inspires them. In order for the mosquito to take such a precaution, it should be aware of the effect of evaporation. It should know the water will leave the ground because of evaporation and other things. Mosquitoes lay their eggs in the summer months or in autumn. The temperature of the place where they lay the eggs is very important. This is an important factor about the development of the larvae. And although the larvae are vulnerable, the eggs are quite resilient to drought and cold. They are created by this way. And if the right conditions are not available, the eggs can wait for rain and rising temperatures without cracking. This is very miraculous. How can egg understand the weather and wait to crack, wait without cracking? And although their time has come to hatch, the eggs can wait without cracking. This is very miraculous. And at times when there is not enough moisture and heat for the eggs to grow, so they stop developing and can keep themselves for months, for example, like this way. And there's a kind of heat-moisture safety fuse in the eggs. We can say this is an assurance. And when the conditions are wrong, the fuse blows and the eggs development program is put on hold. This is paused. And this little creature, said to contain a program, is approximately 1 millimeter size. This is very little, and it has a program inside. Even its DNA, it is encoded, mashallah.
Yes, the embryos act in accordance with the program, as you said, Sister Begum. And this this is a development program,
yes,
for the eggs. And it can happen in the, for example, the abdomen of the mother, or in the egg, but all details of this program is written inside the DNA molecules.
Mashallah, it cannot acquire this property over time.
Yes.
Because it has to be coded in the first generation. Mashallah. And if there is a program, so there must be a programming intelligence that wrote it. Of course, this is just a comparison. It is Allah who created this animal with this so-called program. This is all, of course, a miracle of creation. And this is an animal which is which is written in the Quran. Also, this is very astonishing. And due to this resilience, they are very strong because of these properties. Mosquitoes can be found in every part of the world. For example, there's a lake in Iceland, which is called Mosquito Lake. And there are frozen larvae found in iced over lakes, hatch from the eggs. And when the ice melts, how can they know when they have to hatch? And when the ice melts, these eggs hatch suddenly. And if they are like before that, they were frozen during months. But suddenly they start to hatch and they know that the ice has melt. I have to crash and I have to go out. And there is no distortion in the animal. It stayed frozen during months and suddenly it becomes alive. This is very interesting. We cannot stay like this, but Allah create them with this property. And thanks to this property, they can live in the most hard conditions. And there are very important characteristics of mosquito eggs. Female mosquitoes can lay from 40 to 200 eggs in one time in the water. And the mosquito egg have different characteristics according to the where the species live, according to the environment or dangers. And once the egg leave the mother's side, they are defenseless. They cannot protect themselves. They are motionless prey, we can say. And because they are, when in the first time, they are bright yellow color when they leave their egg. They are bright yellow color. And the color of the legs is very important. When they are legged at night, it turns at black in the morning. Because by this way, it can be camouflaged from insects and birds. It changes color. And some species of mosquitoes, for example, anopheles, are able to change color at the larvae stage and pupal stage. Even it is a larvae, for example, it is black in the morning. It is white, and they put it in the black environment. It becomes black, the larvae. And naturally, neither the egg nor the larva cannot know the color of the environment, how can it change its color. And the color changes by the effect of photons emitted by the sun. And this is a complex chemical process that the animal cannot understand. Even I don't understand this process. There are formulas, different things. And the knowledge of this system is already installed in the DNA, in the cells of the eggshell. And also they are unsinkable eggs. Another type egg. The underside, we can show the picture of this kind of egg. The underside of the egg of the Culex mosquito has a funnel-shaped hollow. And when the air fills the hollow, it acts as a life buoy and it keeps the eggs afloat. However, the hollow can lead to serious problems for the egg. We have another picture. The hollow located under the egg can easily become useless if the egg capsizes. So for this reason, a single egg laid on the water cannot float for a long time. If it loses its balance, it will overturn and the air-filled hollow will fill with water, so the egg will sink and it will die. What would you do in this situation to prevent this danger? So we have another picture here. You will see in detail the structure of the eggs. Mosquitoes solve this problem by sticking the eggs together, as you see in the picture, and the eggs are stuck side by side into a disc shape, and they form a natural floating raft. They are rafting like this way, and this disc is about 11 millimeter, and in diameter it can easily float on the water, on the surface of water, without sinking. And the hollows under the eggs and space between the eggs serves as an air pillow to keep the disc afloat. There are several miracles in these eggs, as you see in the picture. They are side by side, and there is a clever method here. If there is no such a method, it would the eggs would sink and die. And however impossible it may be, let's suppose that the mosquito found the solution by observing other eggs. Let's suppose only. Even if that were the case, if there was no air hollow under the egg, the mosquito's raft would be useless. Because, as you know, it would be filled with water and it would capsize. And this is also very important. It cannot happen over time. And the mosquito is very important. It is created with an adhesive to stick the eggs together. There should be also an adhesive. How could it stick them together? And this adhesive is not dissolved by water over time. It is very strong. And of course, there's also a reason for the shape of the eggs, disc shape. The disc shape is the shape which is best protects the raft from capsizing. If it could be rectangular, it is not so advantageous. And if the water is rippled, it would sink, for example, if the shape was rectangular. And there's also some eggs which are covered by gelatin. And the eggs are laid in a pile of gelatin-like substance. The gelatin mass protects the eggs from being blown away, from drying up, from sudden changes of temperature, and from enemies. In addition, thanks to this substance, the fly sticks the eggs to plants or stones. So by this way, the eggs are not lost in the water. And there's another egg. This is live buoy egg. We can maybe show the picture. This is live buoy egg. The eggs of Anopheles mosquitoes have a special shape and structure to prevent their sinking. As you see in the picture, little air chambers on the outside, of the egg shell and floating edges surrounding the egg keep it above water. The floating edges increase the surface tension of the water, and thanks to this tension, the egg does not sink. MashaAllah, this is very interesting. Their shape also are the same. In the first generation, it was the same. It has never changed. And surface tension creates a force, as we know, which small creatures in particular cannot pass through. And thanks to this surface tension, little animal can walk on the water with ease. As we see, there are several conditions which help them to live, to survive, and there is no possibility of such an attribute being acquired over time. If this structure had failed to appear on the egg just once, all the Anopheles eggs would have sunk to the bottom of water and the mosquito would have died out. So Allah has created the characteristics needed by each creature, as we see in the mosquito. Our duty is to reflect on the perfection of His creation. And I want to finish with a verse of the Quran. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Say, who is the Lord of the heavens and the earth? Say, God. Say, so why have you taken protectors apart from Him, who possess no power to help or harm even themselves? Say, are the blind and seeing equal? Or are darkness and light the same? Or have they assigned partners to God, who create as He creates, so that all creating seems the same to them? Say, God is the creator of all things. He is the one who conquers all. MashaAllah, this is the 13th surah and 16th verse, as we saw in the screen. And there are other properties. We can show maybe the picture of the book, where our brothers and sisters may find more details. The Miracle in the Mosquito, which is a book of Harun Yahya. You can download free on www.harunyahya.com. MashaAllah, this is very MashaAllah. Interesting book.
MashaAllah.
Full of wisdom.
And in you mentioned that in the Quran, Allah mentions mosquito.
Yes.
I seek refuge in Allah from a cursed Satan. God is not ashamed to make an example of a mosquito or even or of an even smaller thing, MashaAllah.
MashaAllah.
This is an example for us. And even in the mosquito or even in a smaller thing, Allah creates a lot of feature for us, MashaAllah.
MashaAllah. Yes.
And I would like to give you some information about the about another creature, the Arctic tern. Sorry, we can see its pictures on the screen also. This animal is about 33 or 39 centimeters long, and it is just 100 grams weight. And actually, it's a very tiny bird. We can see on the screen also. It has a gracious appearance, actually. It has extremely long and slender wings. It is elegant in flight, but its legs, however, are very short, extremely short, which makes the bird appear rather clumsy on the ground. But this bird is known to make the longest longest annual migration among the animal kingdom. During its breeding season, it is found in north, where the summer days are long, and in winters, in the southern hemisphere, where the days are longest during November to February. So this means that the Arctic tern probably experiences more sunlight during a year than the other animals on Earth. That's why they call it the bird of sun, inshallah. It prefers the places where the days are longer, because the change in the daytime affects its hormone system, and somehow it knows it, it understands it, mashallah. Light first stimulates the nerve center, the hypothalamus, and the hypothalamus controls the hunger center. Also, some other centers in the brain also are stimulated. These hormonal changes whets the bird's appetite, and it starts to feed more than before, about 40% more than before. And this, of course, this has a meaning. It's not random, because later it will use this fat stores while migration. And the fat that it when it eats, the fat stores are filled and under the skin, inside its muscles for flight, and also in its abdomen. It starts to get ready for the migration. It starts at the end of the summer and at the beginning of the autumn. But if it had started in the spring, then it wouldn't be able to find enough food where the places it migrates. So the time for migration is perfectly set for the animal to feed themselves, also the new babies that will born soon. And it's very interesting that they are determined to come back to the same place. For example, there's an interesting research done on these birds when they are migrating from South Pole to North Pole. The researchers thrown fish from the observation boats. But the birds didn't, they ignored them. They didn't care about the fish. Actually, it's very strange, because normally the birds should go and eat the fish, but they didn't. As if they were saying, I must reach home immediately. They just didn't stop and went on their ways. Of course, when we think deeply, this bird cannot decide what to do so. And Allah orders it, mashallah. It acts as if it has a purpose. And in a Quran verse, Allah says, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. There is no creature he does not hold by the forelock, mashallah. And I think the most amazing part of their migration is their rod in the air. Normally, the big coast birds can store fat for a travel of 5,000 kilometers, and they follow a straight path. But this Arctic tern is just a tiny animal, and it cannot store that much fat. So it has to make some economy while using its energy. And when they're going back home, for example, they follow an S-shaped road instead of a straight path. And this method makes their way thousands of kilometers longer. So maybe it is more twice longer. But of course, there's a great wisdom here, because it uses the prevailing winds while over the Atlantic Ocean. When there is wind, it doesn't have to spend much energy while passing the ocean. So it flies in the air easily. So it uses its energy in the most efficient way, mashallah. And let's think here for a moment. First, they don't have any measurements or any calculations to measure how many kilometers they should fly, and how they can know what this way, that this way is too long for them, so they should find another way to use their energy less. And most important thing, how can it know that what kind of wind they should need? And when it goes to that place where the wind blows, it exactly finds the way where the wind blows, mashallah. And how can they know if it follows this direction of the wind, it will use less energy, more than before. So this travel is very long and difficult for it normally, but by the will of Allah, mashallah, it survives with a great wisdom. And there's another interesting detail about this migration. All the Arctic terns living on the Earth knows this information. They always follow the S-shaped route, mashallah, other than the other birds. And I want to mention another point. These birds migrate to south, over South America, and some of them over Africa coast. But when they are coming back to their home, they always follow the same path. For example, when we think about ourselves, to find our way, we use, we need maps, compass, navigation systems, and without them, it's very difficult for us to find the way. Also, even how good someone describes the way, we may even forget it, or we may go in the wrong direction by mistake. Also, for our daily life, we have a lot of signs on our roads. We name all the streets, we name all the buildings, but still, we may not find our direction correctly. But
this small, so
yes, inshallah, but this small birds doesn't have any signs on the way that show them how many kilometers left to the north or where is north, but it finds its way perfectly, mashallah. In order to better understand the perfection of Allah's creation, we have to think deeply on the examples that Allah show us, mashallah. And for example, when we think about this Arctic tern, we clearly understand that Allah has created it with all these systems, mashallah. And Allah also states in the Quran that draws attention to the birds.
Yes.
I would like to read you the verse, inshallah. We can see on screen also. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Have they not looked at the birds above them? With wings outspread and folded back, nothing holds them up but all merciful. He sees all things. Surah Al-Mulk, verse 19. Mashallah.
We gave two examples of the animals from the nature, and mashallah, Allah created us for us a lot of examples to understand that they are the signs to faith. And right now, I will continue with a kind of a miracle of the plants. When we observe the plants and the plants' growth, we can easily realize that the most difficult function is achieved by the root and under the soil. And the physical and chemical events that take place inside the root and also the root structure, they form a very special mechanism. And when the root system is examined with all of its structural features, it is seen that a plant has the most perfect qualities to acquire water and food from the soil. And we know that the root structure begins to surface with the seed sprouting. And the first emerging root is called the primary root. This root emerges from the growth region in the inside the embryo in the seed. And the primary root grows slowly in the direction of the gravity and thickens and also starts to grow helper roots connected to itself. And this helper root also has the name. It is the secondary root. And these secondary roots, the helper roots, has actually has a different and unique system that they are working together, this primary and the secondary root. And how does it work? When the primary root, for example, sometimes somehow with any reason the primary root cannot do its duty, and in these conditions somehow the secondary root understand that right now the first one cannot do its duty, so it takes over its function and starts to grow in the direction of the primary root. Right now we can understand that there is a miracle, because with this unconscious little rootens can understand that there is something going wrong And so it feels responsible for this and decides to grow in the way of a primary root, mashallah. And we can also say that this is a kind of a backup root system, like in the computers. And we know that also scientists have experimented about the size of the root surface needed, water, and also the inorganic materials in water to be absorbed by the root. And the experiment conducted on the rye plant to find the size. We can see on the screen the rye plant, the example, one of the examples. And also the second one we can see. These are the plants that were used in the experiment of the scientists to understand the size. And actually, the experiment has given very surprising results because this rye plant was taken out of the soil and sometime later, and after its roots were washed, then it had become thinner in size. And it was then calculated that the rye root has grown, right now this is very important, 13,800,000 branches. We can see on the screen, this is the root of the rye. And as I said before, 13,800,000 branches it produces. And also all of these take up a root surface 235 kilometer, it is written meter, but it has to be kilometer square total root surface. And it is an amazing amount. And as a result of this research, it was found that the area of the roots, water, and food absorption equaled of an area 635 kilometers square. And we are talking about the branches under the soil. We are not aware what's going on normally, but there is a life. There are a lot of miracles going on under the soil.
There is a consciousness.
Yes, consciousness, absolutely, mashallah. And at the end, it is understood that this activity is carried out by the plant roots under the ground, reached amazing extent, as I said before. And also, it is not hard to understand or think that these branches, these roots are very little and also very delicate, because they are very tiny as a hair.
Yes,
very fragile. Mm-hmm. And we know that soil is very tough, actually. So at this point, it is really a very difficult mission for the roots to go under the soil and move there. Mm-hmm. But somehow, these little roots enter and move inside the soil with its weak structure. And because the soil has an uneven and also the granulated structure, but the rootlets, of course, has to deal with this and with this great friction forces also. Of course, there is another problem. There is a friction force right now in front of these roots. And so how could the root resist against these friction roots and not even get, grow in the soil without any harm? And when the rootlets emerge from the seed, they emit a special secretion with a chemical composition, and this protects them from friction once they enter the soil. And this special secretion makes the root surface slippery so that the root is protected against the harm and negative effects of the friction caused of the root enters the soil and moves go ahead. And also the area of the top of the root has a name. It is the root head, and this part is also has also a conical shape. And this part, when first meets with the friction, and this shape allows to the root to decrease friction force to a minimum while moving along the soil, and also easily pierce the soil. And
mashallah.
And as you said, as it is seen, the root has all that befits it. And there is an intelligence here. The intelligence belongs to Allah, mashallah. Mm-hmm. And also it appears that it knows what it will face under the ground before coming out of the seed, mashallah.
And there is one more thing that I would like to mention about the roots. Let's see again this picture on the screen. When we at the first look, this branch-like structure of the root seems to be complicated and also unordered. But however, there is a new field of science, geometry, emerged in recent years. And the mathematical rules it provided has shown that the structures that cannot otherwise be explained by the complexity of the classical geometry, but actually also they look like they are branchy, but they also have an order. How can it be happened? This, firstly, I want to mention this new field of geometry, that it is the fractal geometry. And the fractal word means the broken up, also divided. And there is a actually there was a scientist called named Benoit Mandelbrot, and he proved that when he was working on a on his one of the research, some forms maybe cannot be explained by non-geometrical shapes, but they also have the proportions of their own. And they show this in the computer programs. And there is a quotation here. This scientist said on the screen, we can see that Benoit Mandelbrot says that neither the clouds are round, nor the mountains are conic, nor the seashores are circular, nor the tree pills are straight, nor lightning moves in the direction of straight lines. All of these examples are the examples from the nature, but they also, maybe they are not have the normally exact shapes. They are not, as the scientist says, they are not conic, they are not triangle, but they have the geometrical shapes on their own, and the parts of the, that form the part of the structure of the plant's roots, and are the helper roots that emerge from the primary roots. And this geometrical quality is necessary process for the root. And for example, there are research about the branching density of roots in soil, and this has shown that for the plant roots to complete their functions, branching needs to have the most optimal density. And scientists have calculated the most optimal branching density for a root under the ground with their computer techniques, and also compared the results with the plant roots growing in the natural habitat. And the results showed values very close to one another in a miraculous way. And as we've seen, they calculated with the fractal geometry in the computer, and they had the same, nearly the same reason from the examples which the plants were from the natural habitat, and they're approximately the same. And it shows that actually there is an intelligence here. Even it is under the soil, even we cannot see, witness in our daily life, there are a lot of miracles going on, and this is only the one of them, mashallah. And I want to read some Quran verse to, we can see on the screen, I seek refuge in Allah from a cursed Satan. Have you thought about what you cultivate? Is it you who make it germinate, or are we the germinator? If we wished, we could have made it broken stubble. You would then be left devoid of crops, this drought. Surat al-Waqi'ah, verses 63 and 65.
MashaAllah. And also it is very important that to understand that all the roots that you have expressed, they are so weak and fragile. And also Sayyid Nursi Bediüzzaman has a saying about these roots and how strong they are. Although they are so much fragile, they are very strong because they are saying the word Bismillah in the name of Allah. And I want to read a quotation from his the first word, his one of his writings. If we, like the other creatures, obey Allah and act as He asks us to, He will save us, and He is always there for us. Just as He helps the weak, fragile plant stems to break through hard rocks, He will help us overcome the seemingly unbreakable obstacles. If we desire the love of Allah, we should take in the name of Allah, given the name of Allah name and refuse anything from anyone who does not given his name.
Mashallah.
And for now we will have a short break and then we will continue.
The end times and the fact of creation.
Assalamu alaikum, dear brothers and sisters. We are continuing to our topics. And first of all, we will continue with the science leading to faith topic. This is something very different, actually. It is about the space this time, and the dark matter and dark energy. And I would like to show you something on the screen. As you can see on the screen now, space is a very stunning place for all of us and also the scientists. And Allah created a perfect order in the universe from nothing. You can see the Earth picture now. And we can see the magnificence of Allah and the creation of universe. We know the name of this start point as Big Bang.
And also Allah mentions this in the Quran, I seek refuge in Allah from a curse, Satan. As for heaven, we build it with great power and gave it its vast expanse. Meaning, inshallah, we widen it.
Yes, and it is a miracle of Quran. Mm. And you can see on the screen how about something about expanding. And it is expanse as it is written in the Quran, in the verses. And we will talk about it later also. But if we continue about it, scientists used to claim that they have learned so much about the things that they say, because the universe, because they are using high technology equipments, working very hard. But after the discovery of something that we will talk about, the dark matter, which is invisible to the naked eye, they really surprised. They were shocked and confessed about that they know so less about the universe and also the space. And we will continue now. When you, for example, look at the sky and look at everything, you see the moon, the stars, and also there are special systems, you know, about the stars and the astronomy. But Allah created them all together with a great balance. We know that Big Bang is an explosion, it's something like that. And Allah says that created with a great strength. But there is a very strong balance and a very beautiful, very perfect order gets out of this strength, gets out of this explosion. And now I will tell you about the dark matter. This is something, this is a taken picture actually. This is something they say that they saw the dark matter in here. These are two galaxies coming together to each other. And this, when we look at the sky, as we said, we see the stars. But these stars, when we look at them, they seem very small. But they are not as small as we assume. They understood that when we look at the stars with the visible, with eyes or telescopes, optic telescopes, electromagnetic telescopes, we observe something. But these are the things that emitting or scattering light or electromagnetic field or something like that. But when they calculated the mass of these stars or the planets or anything, also the Earth, they found that there is something more, much more heavier than it is seen. I mean, it contains too much mass. And when they try to understand why it is happening like this, because of the gravity. Everything has itself, it has a gravity, and they are pulling each other, all the matters. But when we look at the structure of the gravity and its pulling effect, it is much more bigger than it is size. So there is something in everything that we cannot see. And also some of the professors and all the investigators, scientists, astronomers from NASA, some of them, they explained this as they don't know what this matter is, but it is exist. Because they cannot understand it or they cannot express it with any kind of technique. Although they have very high-tech equipment, they cannot explain it because there is something out in the space, not interacting with photons. And also it is electrically neutral, so it won't give any electromagnetic field. And also highly non-relativistic. And also it is dispositionless, it says. And they can only detect its gravity. That's all. And so 70 astronomers measured the shape of the galaxies, and they found that this dark matter, it is dark. And they actually calculated 500,000 galaxies, and they make a survey on it. And they try to find how big they are, their mass, their sizes, how many of them has these dark shape and the dark matter, and how big is this dark matter. And again, when you look at the slide in here, you will see that very small sizes in here, like 17%, is luminous. It means visible. And 83% is dark. Actually, this dark meaning is doesn't mean that it is black. It is transparent. It is something that is transparent, mashallah. And let's continue. I would like to show you a video about the people in NASA talking about the dark matter. And in a minute.
The Chandra X-ray Observatory orbits high above the Earth, peering into the blackest reaches of space. Exploring the most menacing and magnificent features of the cosmos, this remarkable telescope is revealing what our eyes can't, taking us beyond visible light. Peering into the dark with its X-ray vision, NASA's Chandra X-ray Observatory is helping to unravel one of astronomy's most perplexing enigmas. Clusters of starlit galaxies in searing hot gas somehow stay together, even though the stars and gas themselves don't have enough mass or gravity to explain their bond. What cosmic ingredient is lurking in the darkness, undetectable by any of our telescopes, holding these spinning groups together when they should be flung apart?
And to hold the gas and the galaxies in place, you have to have this additional material. You can compute how much there is, and it's about, again, close to 10 times more than we see in the gas and in the stars. And this material, because it doesn't radiate X-rays, it doesn't radiate light, it doesn't radiate in the infrared, we feel the force of its gravity. We know it's there, but we can't see it, so we call it dark material, dark matter.
Light waves from normal matter can be detected by a variety of telescopes, such as optical, X-ray, infrared, gamma ray, and more. Dark matter, on the other hand, is visible only through its gravitational effects on the matter we can see around it. In August 2006, Chandra and other telescopes working together found direct proof of dark matter with a breakthrough discovery in a galaxy cluster known as the Bullet Cluster. When the Bullet Cluster's galaxies merged, the clouds of gas slowed down due to friction, but the galaxies themselves slipped through the collision.
The galaxies in the dark matter, they act more like individual particles, and so they interact through the force of gravity, but they don't behave like a gas or a fluid, and it tells us something about the interactions of the dark matter, namely it doesn't interact with itself other than through the force of gravity. And we actually have physically separated, we haven't personally separated, but in this Bullet Cluster, the dark matter and the gas have been separated, and you actually can see the concentration of the dark matter offset from the concentration of the gas. And it's a very visual demonstration that the dark matter is real, and it's different from the ordinary material of the baryons and gas.
The mystery deepened once more in August 2007. Chandra and optical telescopes revealed that in the Abel 520 galaxy cluster, dark matter behaved in an opposite manner from the Bullet Cluster. Instead of staying with the galaxies, the dark matter collected in the center of the cluster, while the bright galaxies collected detected outside the core. Undaunted by this new finding, astronomers are not giving up.
Also for studying dark matter is important because most of the cluster mass, it turns out to be the form of dark matter. So, and clusters are so big that the composition of clusters is exactly the same as that of the entire universe.
Using valuable tools like Chandra, the best scientific minds are working to reveal what dark matter really is and the role it plays in the universe. But for now, this matter continues to keep us in the dark.
MashaAllah. Actually, it is something very miraculous because Allah shows, Allah creates something that is invisible but exists. And whatever they try to do, it doesn't matter. It exists all the time. And I want to show another picture. This is the 3D plot of the dark matter in the universe that they made it with the 3D workings. And also I want to talk about something as stunning as the dark matter. It is the dark energy this time. And scientists detected they have a theory. As we said, it starts with an explosion, they said. So, and the universe is expanding as it is written in the Quran. And we have said that we will talk about it again. And now I want to say, as it is expanding, scientists decided that it should slow down as it started from a point with a very big explosion. So it keeps on going to expand, but they assume that it should slow down or stop somehow. And then they tried to make an experiment to see if it is really slowing down or what's happening. And I want to show you something. You see a supernova on the screen. This is an explosion, a star explosion. And they tried to calculate the light coming from this explosion. And first of all, when they see the explosion, it gets a light. But when they calculate it for time to time, they see that the light is becoming dimmer. It becomes darker. And it becomes dark so fast that they understand that the universe is expanding faster than they assumed. And now they shocked again. They were surprised so much again, because when they look at the structure of the expansion, when they look at the structure of the universe, it's expanding much more than they have ever expected. So this is something very miraculous, because they say that because of the gravity of the galaxies, because of the gravity of the planets, they should coming together, not expanding that much. And then they understand that there should be a force, an unseen force in the universe that make the universe expand. And it is stated in the Quran, as it is stated in the Quran, Allah makes the universe expand. Because they cannot understand it, how it is happening. There should be a force, an unseen force. They call it dark because they cannot see it. MashaAllah.
There is also a very delicate equilibrium in the expansion of the universe. I want to read a quotation of Stephen Hawking, and he says, if the rate of expansion 1 second after the Big Bang had been smaller by even one part in 100,000,000,000,000, the universe would have recollapsed before it ever reached its present size.
Yes.
MashaAllah, this is all under control of Allah.
Yes, and this expansion is always under control,
yes.
As we said. Only a small change in this expansion causes a collapse.
Yes.
Yes, and any kind of difference, it can never happen. And it is getting faster, but we are never feeling it. And also, I would like to show you a pie chart. Now you can see on the screen. This is something that they try to explain. This is something that we see, we can see in the universe. This is the dark matter, this is the dark energy. The things that we can see in the universe is just this thin. And when we try to look at it, there are some of the stars in here, some heavy elements, some neutrinos, some other structures, but just 4% that we can see in the universe. This is something very miraculous. Of course, Allah holds the planet all the time. Allah holds the universe like this. And even if it is moving so fast, we are not feeling it. We are just sitting on the chair, and we are just going to our work. We are just doing everyday things that we do. But if Allah wills, anything can come from the outer space to us and cause a very serious damage. But it is not happening. Allah holds everything, mashallah, for us and for our good, and for we have a time to live for now. And Earth and the universe has a time. They have a
collapse.
Yes,
also.
Inshallah. And sometime at the end times, we are now, and in the recurrence day, and the end day, and everything will be finished. Yes. And everybody will see the glory of that day, inshallah. And so I want to say that Allah has a name, the All Glorious, Al Adib. I want to read a verse about it. I seek refuge with Allah from the curse Satan. Everything in the heavens and everything in the earth belongs to Him. He is the Most High, the All Glorious. Surat As-Sura, verse 4. Inshallah.
So if you want, we can change the topic. We can talk about end times, about Hazrat Mehdi. And as we know, throughout the history, Allah has created every community of believers with a leader. For example, the Prophet Noah alayhi salam was the leader of believers in his time. The Prophet Moses alayhi salam was the leader of believers in his time. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the leader of the companions in his time, and Talut was the leader of in his time, and Dhulqarnain also in his time, and Hazrat Mehdi alayhi salam himself personally will be the spiritual leader of Muslims in the end times that we are living now. And the idea that Muslims should be leaderless, while the Catholics, the Orthodox, the Jews, even the Freemasons also, every community has a leader. And while however, some people claim that the Muslims should not have a leader. This is just the ignoring of sufferings of Muslims in the world. If we want to put an end to all the sufferings, we should search the Mehdi alayhi salam. That will be our spiritual leader in the end times now. And Allah commands us in the Quran not to be divided. We should act together, all Muslims in the world. And I want to read a verse of the Quran. And before that, I want to mention another thing. If Muslims do not abide by this command of Allah, and if they fail to coalesce around one spiritual leader, then it will not be possible for the difficulties that we are living now to come an end. And the path that Allah shows us in the Quran to Muslims is that of those who, when they are wronged, defend themselves. This is a verse of the Quran, Surat Ash-Shu'ara, verse 39. And it must not be forgotten that there is another verse we should also reminded to all Muslims, brothers and sisters. Allah loves those who strive in His way in ranks like well-built walls. This is Surat As-Saf, verse 4. And it is Hazrat Mehdi alayhi salam in person who will bring the Muslims of the world together in our own day. To strive on Allah's path with knowledge, with science, with information, who will protect them against the scourge of Darwinism, materialism, the Antichrist, the Dajjal. And Hazrat Mehdi will also cause Islamic morals to prevail the entire world, like in the time of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I want to read a hadith about these properties of Hazrat Mehdi alayhi salam. Four people became kings on earth. Two are believers, two are unbelievers. The believers are Dhulqarnain alayhi salam and the Prophet Solomon alayhi salam. The unbelievers are Nimrod and Bakhtinars. One from the people of my house, Hazrat Mehdi alayhi salam, will come as the fifth, and he will be king of earth. This is Al-Mutaki Al-Hindi Al-Burhan Fi Alamet Al-Mehdi Akir Al-Zaman, page 10. And Hazrat Mehdi, this is another verse, hadith. Hazrat Mehdi alayhi salam will spiritually conquer the east and west of the world and bring Islam, it means Islamic moral values, to rule across the world. This is a very important, we have to announce this fact, everybody. Islam will rule on the world
in our days, in our century. And Almighty Allah will give people such a power that everyone will hear His voice from where they are. It makes reference to television, radio, to internet, as we are living now. And Hazrat Mehdi will give life to Islam. It will flourish everybody who does not know Islam, and it will strengthen our belief in Allah, inshallah. And according to the Quran, the dominion of the morality of Islam over the world is an obligation. This is our obligation. We are obliged to strive for the dominion of Islam in the world. In several verses, Allah gives the news of dominion of the morality of Islam over the world and promises it. MashaAllah. And the promise of our Lord Almighty Allah is true. And Allah never fails to keep His promise. And those who believe in Allah also believe that Allah's promise will absolutely come true. I want to finish with a verse of the Quran. This is Surat An-Nur, verse 55. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Allah has promised those of you who believe and do right actions that He will make them successors in land as He made those before them successors, and will firmly establish for them their religion with which He is pleased, and give them, in place of their fear, security. They worship Me, not associating anything with Me. Any who are unbelievers after that, such people are deviators. This is very important. Islam will rule the world, and we will see it, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Alhamdulillah.
Also, in another verse, Allah again promises that Islam will prevail all over the world, and the believers will be victors. Yes. In Surah Saffat, I would like to read you the verse. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Our word was given before to our slaves, the messengers, that they would certainly be helped. It is our army which will be victors.
MashaAllah.
Allah calls the believers as My army, MashaAllah.
MashaAllah.
And as you mentioned, some of the people cannot understand why the Muslims have to have a leader. Yes. And once the student of the Sheikh Nazim el-Kubrisi el-Hakkani, the Sheikh Ahmed Yasin, said that the problem in some of the circles, in the some of the environment in the Islamic world, everyone is looking for his own Mehdi. But actually there is one Mehdi, and he is the Allah's Mehdi. And so He will show us the right path. It will be the Allah's path. And we will see that, inshallah, He will prevail the Islamic moral values all over the world. And in one of the hadiths, our Prophet says that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a little more than 1,000 years pass over the passing of Allah's messenger from this life, a time comes and the true Islam rises from its own ranks and unites with the truth of the Kaaba, inshallah. And this shows that it is inshallah, and we are right now in the end times, and we see that most of the importance of the Hazrat Mehdi alayhi salam emerged. And actually last night or this week, Mr. Adnan Oktar said that Allah has the power to create the other also the importance of the Hazrat Mehdi alayhi salam. He made the 99% of these portents emerged, and of course, inshallah, Allah has the power to emerge the 100% of these portents, and we will see inshallah, we will witness all these portents will become in front of our eyes in this era.
And also tonight, Mr. Adnan Oktar again said that this is the destiny. Inshallah. Whatever, whoever would like to do anything to stop, to make something mm-hmm. different, it doesn't matter. This is the destiny, and it will happen, inshallah.
And as we said, Prophet Jesus alayhi salam and Hazrat Mehdi will come in this century. We have a video, maybe we can show it, about the date of their coming, Hazrat Mehdi's coming. This is the year 1400 of Hijri calendar. We can see on the screen the video.
Of the end times foretold of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and that have been taking place one after the other as of 1400 Hijri, and statements by great Islamic scholars on the subject are a rebuttal of those who falsely say that Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam will not be coming in this century. The Imams of all the schools and great Islamic scholars are all in agreement that Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam will come in this century, as foretold by our Prophet, peace be upon him, the true reporter. Our Prophet, peace be upon him, reported in the Hadiths that the portents of the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam would take place one after another, like the beads on a necklace, and that this would herald his appearance. The Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, "Let them expect portents taking place one after the other like the beads of a necklace whose string has snapped." Just about all the events known as the portents of the end times in the hadith of our Prophet, peace be upon him, and foretelling the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam in the present century, began taking place as of Hijri 1400 or 1979 AD, one after the other, like the beads on a necklace, just as our Prophet, peace be upon him, told. Those who misinterpret the words of Imam Rabbani and claim that Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam will not appear in Hijri 1400 are gravely mistaken. That is because his appearance will be at the beginning of the century. 18 years have currently gone by since the beginning of the century. Imam Rabbani, Letters of Rabbani, letter number 381, page 1184. Those who misinterpret this passage from Imam Rabbani, saying that 30 years have passed since the beginning of Hijri century we are in, since we are now in Hijri 1430, and thus maintain that the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam must take place in some other century, are gravely mistaken. In this extract from the letters, Imam Rabbani said that Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam had not appeared in his own day, even though 18 years had gone by since the start of the century, and that it was now impossible for him to appear in that century. He offered two important pieces of evidence for this. First proof. The first piece of evidence submitted by Imam Rabbani is the condition that Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam must appear at the start of the century. Second proof. The second piece of evidence submitted on this subject by Imam Rabbani is the need for all the portents of the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam, foretold by our Prophet, peace be upon him, taking place one after the other at the start of a Hijri century. That is because his appearance will be at the beginning of the century. 18 years have currently gone by since the beginning of the century. The importance of the signs of the appearance of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam, our Prophet, peace be upon him, revealed in the hadiths taking place one after the other, is emphasized. For that reason, Imam Rabbani says that although 18 years have passed since the beginning of his Hijri century, since none of the portents showing the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam had taken place, Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam will not be coming in his century. The fact these portents have come about is one of the clearest signs that the Mahdi alayhi salam will not appear in Imam Rabbani's day. 2. In addition, none of the signs cited by our Prophet, peace be upon him, as foretelling the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam took place one after the other during the century in which Imam Rabbani lived, or up until Hijri 1400. These portents never took place one after the other in any century since our Prophet's time, until Hijri 1400. 3. With the beginning of Hijri 1400, these portents began taking place one after the other like the beads on a breaking necklace scattering in all directions. However, those who make such illogical inferences as saying, "We are now in Hijri 1430s, but Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam has not yet appeared," that means that the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam is postponed until some other century, are trying to cover up and gloss over the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam. But this statement by Al-Barzanji, a most important and trustworthy Sunni scholar, refutes this foolish claim. 4, 5, or even 10 years are regarded as the first years of the century. Accordingly, that Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam will appear 7, 9, or 30 years before the 100th year is no obstacle to his coming at the beginning of the century. The same applies if his appearance is after that period. Therefore, by these words, Hasan al-Barzanji is saying that the fact that he's recognized 7, 9, or even 30 years before or after Hijri 1400, the date of his appearance, is no obstacle to Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam appearing in Hijri 1400. It is clear from these statements that even if Hazrat Mahdi, alayhi salam, appears 30 years after Hijri 1400, he will still be the great Mahdi, alayhi salam, foretold to Muslims by our Prophet, peace be upon him, 1400 years ago. The date of the coming of Hazrat Mahdi, alayhi salam, as Hijri 1400 is confirmed by being revealed by our Prophet, peace be upon him, in trustworthy hadiths, and by the portents of his coming taking place one after the other, as of Hijri 1400.
Yes, we are living in a very important century. Inshallah, we will see Hazrat Mehdi alayhi salam and Prophet Jesus alayhi salam.
Inshallah.
This is very, this gives emotion, and we have to tell everybody that we are living in end times.
This gives enthusiasm.
Yes,
also,
the judgment day is very close, and we have to pay attention to what we are doing, how we are using our time, how we are propagate, diffusing Islam, what we are doing for Allah every day.
Inshallah. And now tonight we have come to the end of our speak. And tomorrow at 3 a.m. GMT plus 2, we will be together in the channel A9 in the Harun Yahya studios. Until then, have a nice day and Selamun Aleyküm.